Good morning. Did that seem a little strong to you, the PA? We were monkeying around with it for something coming later in the service, so. We'll just have to do the boost at the end. Good morning. We welcome you as we gather in the presence of our Lord on this celebration of the day of Pentecost. In the Jewish community, it's known as Shavuot, and it celebrates the day of the giving of the Torah, not the receiving of the Torah. I just read that this week. In the Jewish community, at least among conservatives, it is said that one never is finished receiving the word from God. So that's a nice orientation. A couple of announcements for you. On Tuesday here, there will be a meeting of the call committees and the church councils for both St. Thomas and Christ Manaway to coordinate the plans for the ordination and installation of the new pastor. You'd be welcome to come and join us, so that if you have some input or some ideas that you'd like to, or would be willing to volunteer to take care of some things, I'm sure that would be most acceptable. So that'll happen here on Tuesday evening. The date for that installation and ordination is set for July the 8th. That's a Saturday, and it means likely that we will have a early afternoon ordination.
It's Christ's newsletter said at 1 o'clock here and then 3:30 over there.
I know what they said. That's going to be determined finally on Tuesday. So okay. That's part of the reason for the Tuesday meeting. But the idea is that we will have an early afternoon service here for the ordination and installation when the bishop can be with us. And then they'll do an installation for a pastor at Christ Manaway later that afternoon. The suggestion was 1 and 3 or 3:30, so there's time in between. But Christ is offering to host a dinner after their service, so we would all be invited to be part of that. But I'll have more details for you on next Sunday after our meeting on Tuesday. I think was there anything out of council last week that we need to, we need to have a congregational meeting to talk about the arrangements and agreement that has been struck between Christ and St. Thomas churches. And it involves a number of details, including finances and scheduling and all that kind of stuff. So we need to set a date, preferably before the 8th of July, to have that discussion. So next week is Trinity Sunday. The week after that is Confirmation Sunday. The week after that is Father's Day. So things are a little tight for having a Sunday meeting, although we certainly could have it next Sunday without a big problem, unless we have to do something. That's what I was afraid of. In some churches, they say, well, this is the first week, and when we announce it before church next week, it'll be the second week. So constitutionally, that's Robert's rules. That's really not allowed, but we do it anyhow. So we'll see. We'll keep you apprised of how we need to move with that, but we do need to have that meeting. For our worship this morning, we use the order of service printed out in your bulletin. I invite you to rise for the opening dialogue. On the day of Pentecost, the life of the Spirit was poured out onto all parts of the world. On the day of Pentecost, the life of the Spirit entered into Peter, and he began to preach.
Today the Spirit is alive in the words of all those who preach God's
On the day of Pentecost, the life of the Spirit caused people to speak the gospel in many languages.
Today, the Spirit is alive in words that we use to defend the faith in the presence of those who do not yet believe.
On the day of Pentecost, the life of the Spirit inspired many to be baptized and to live as children of God. On the day of Pentecost, the life of the Spirit stirred in the hearts of those who had fallen away from God.
Today, the Spirit is alive in the hearts of those who repent.
On the day of Pentecost, the life of the Spirit drew people who were eager to know more about Christ's love.
Today, the Spirit is alive where people are learning more about God's word.
On the day of Pentecost, the life of the Spirit moved people to become Christ's disciples. Come, Holy Spirit.
And spread your life among us.
Of all, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord,
this holy house and for all who offer here their worship and praise. Let us pray to the Lord. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. O God,
holy cobwebs, the dust, the seeds of dissension, refresh us with your windy presence.
Burn through this sanctuary, O God.
Burning off the dross of our sins, kindling in us the bright fire of your love.
Drench us with your spirit, O God.
Pour on us the cooling waters of your kindness, the refreshing baptismal waters of your grace.
As we remember the grand and glorious day of the coming of your promised Holy Spirit, inspire us with your Spirit this day.
Lead us to our fellowship, burn through this sanctuary, drench us with your Spirit.
Then we will truly serve you through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. He lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now
and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. When the day of Pentecost had come, they were all together in one place. And suddenly from heaven there came a sound like the rush of a violent wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. Divided tongues as of fire appeared among them, and a tongue rested on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages, as the Spirit gave them ability. Now there were devout Jews from every nation under heaven living in Jerusalem. And at this sound the crowd gathered and was bewildered, because each one heard them speaking in the native language of each. Amazed and astonished, they asked, "Are not all these who are speaking Galileans? And how is it that we hear each of us in our own native language? Parthians, Medes, Elamites, and residents of Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt and the parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabs, in our own languages we hear them speaking about God's deeds of power. All were amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, 'What does this mean?' But others sneered and said, 'They are filled with new wine.' But Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed them, 'Men of Judea and all who live in Jerusalem, let this be known to you and listen to what I say. Indeed, these are not drunk, as you suppose, for it is only 9 o'clock in the morning. No, this is what was spoken through the prophet Joel. In the last days it will be, God declares, that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. Even upon my slaves, both men and women, in those days I will pour out my spirit, and they shall prophesy. And I will show portents in the heavens above, and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and smoky mist. The sun shall be turned to darkness, and the moon to blood, before the coming of the Lord's great and glorious day. Then everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved.' This is the word of the Lord."
Thanks be to God.
We should now sing the psalm hymn, "Lord, yours, Lord, is wisdom, yours alone." Reading from St. Paul's first letter to the church at Corinth. No one can say Jesus is Lord except by the Holy Spirit. Now there are varieties of gifts, but the same Spirit, And there are varieties of services, but the same Lord. And there are varieties of activities, but it is the same God who activates all of them in everyone. To each is given the manifestation of the Spirit for the common good. To one is given through the Spirit the utterance of wisdom, and to another the utterance of knowledge according to the same Spirit. To another faith by the same Spirit, to another gifts of healing by the one Spirit, to another the working of miracles, to another prophecy, to another the discernment of spirits, to another various kinds of tongues, to another the interpretation of tongues. All these are activated by one and the same Spirit, who allots to each one individually just as a Spirit chooses. For just as a body is one and has many members, and all the members of the body, though many, are one body, so it is with Christ. For in the one Spirit we were all baptized into one body, Jews or Greeks, slaves or free, and we were all made to drink of one Spirit. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Hold it. There's a sequence hymn that should be sung now. It should say it in your bulletin. 473. Never mind. You can be seated. Gospel according to St. John, the 7th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. On the last day of the festival of the tabernacles, the great day, while Jesus was standing there, he cried out, "Let anyone who is thirsty come to me, and let the one who believes in me drink. As the scripture has said, out of the believer's heart shall flow rivers of living water." Now he said this about the Spirit, which believers in him were to receive, for as yet there was no Spirit, because Jesus was not yet glorified. This is the gospel of our Lord. praise to you, O Christ. Please be seated. On many occasions, we have used a phrase like, Holy Spirit, come. It comes in our prayers. Our opening hymn made that invocation. The sequence hymn seems to follow it. And we're going to repeat like words yet a few more times as we continue our worship. On one level, it's very appropriate for us to thus invoke the Holy Spirit. Although I do believe that we really ought to at least understand what it is we're doing when we do this. Martin Luther once wrote, Omni salve est extra nos. All salvation is outside of us. Luther was combating a sentiment that was rampant in the church of his day and time. A sentiment that said, salvation is indeed from God, but that God expected us to meet him at least part of the way. According to that view, which Luther so strongly rejected, we humans had to do our part, shape up, as it were, get our act together, do the right thing, and in a number of other aphorisms that still echo around in the church today. Luther labeled such notions as Pelagian, a term derived from the name of a 4th century teacher of the church who champions just such a view. A view that the Council of Nicaea branded as heresy. All salvation is outside of us, Luther countered to those who perpetuated that view in his day. God does it all. That was his point. We are but recipients of his grace. We do not cooperate. We do not collaborate. We do not activate this salvation. We receive it. That is, we come to trust it, and then we trust in it. That's called faith, and it is the work of the Holy Spirit. In Luke's Gospel, we hear Jesus instruct the apostles to wait in the city of Jerusalem, quote, until you are clothed with power from on high. He was speaking of the Holy Spirit, who had been promised to, but not yet received and realized by, the disciples. Today we celebrate that event. The disciples waiting for the fulfillment of that promise and not having any idea what to expect. It's really hard for us to put ourselves in their shoes, to go back through the centuries and realize what must have been running through their minds as they sat for 10 days in the upper room waiting for something. But what? What was this power from on high going to be like? Was it going to be like lightning? Was it dangerous? What would that power do for them? What would it do in them? What might it do to them? They had no clue. Oh yes, Jesus had given them indications like, he will lead you into all truth, and he will take what is mine and give it to you. But what did that tell them, really? Now, we cannot help but interpret their experiences in light of the history that we have come to know. But they were imbued with gifts of healing, speaking in tongues, prophecy, and spiritual discernment. And these gifts became immediately evident in their ministry. As a result of those gifts, thousands and tens of thousands of people came to faith. So we can attest to what this power from on high would do in, to, and for them. It would transform their lives, and their lives would transform the world. In that upper room, before that spirit, that power from on high had come upon them, I am sure, now I have no scriptural attestation to prove this, but I am sure these disciples must have prayed something like, Holy Spirit, come. They had a promise from Jesus. They trusted that promise, even that they knew nothing by way of experience to know how that promise was going to be fulfilled, how it would come upon their lives, what it would look like. They knew none of that. Now, what do we mean when we say, Holy Spirit, come? Are we giving expression to the deepest longings of our heart? Are we seeking that power which Jesus had promised to the first disciples? Or are we even more like they are, without a clue, not really knowing what come Holy Spirit truly means? Let me see if I can help with a couple of illustrations. Carol, would you come up here for a moment? Come up here. All right. Now, notice I kept telling her to come up here to the point where it only became insulting and unnecessary. She's already here. Right? And now that I have you here, I have nothing to say to you. I've called you up for no good reason. Aren't you happy? I really have nothing to say to you or anything for you to do. So I guess you can go back to where you were.
Did a good job.
Yay. Now, is that how it is between the Holy Spirit and us? Do we invoke the Holy Spirit and then ignore the Spirit's presence? Keep asking the Spirit to come when it's plain the Spirit came ages ago? Is it that we say we want the Holy Spirit, but we're not quite sure what it is we want the Holy Spirit for? What is the Holy Spirit supposed to do in us, for us, to us, and through us? Well, let's look at a different invocation and see if we can shed some light. We begin our worship most often with the words, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. We're going to talk some more about that next Sunday, which is Trinity Sunday. But for now, we call that an invocation from the Latin word invocare, which means to call in or to summon. I think it's almost universally understood that we begin our worship with those words on the assumption that we are asking the triune God to come and take a central place as we gather for worship. Well, so much for universal and conventional wisdom. That is not what is happening. At least it's not what should be happening. Now think it through for a moment. At what point in the relationship with God were you ever given permission to summon God? Address him? Certainly. Call out to him? Absolutely. While no one I know would ever say it this way, this view of the invocation amounts to us saying to God, hey God, get your butt down here. If I were to lead off our worship with those words, I think you would all quite rightly scurry me off to the nearest mental health facility. What really is going on with those words in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit? And you notice I make the action every time I say it. It's that we are invoking the memory and thus the power of our baptisms. It's not that we are bidding God to come to a place where God would not otherwise choose to be. Remember, Jesus had already promised us, where two or three are gathered in my name, I am there among them. Let me make sure I emphasize the present tense there. I am there. Not I'm going to be, I might show up, I am there. So we are not reminding ourselves that God has summoned us to stand in his presence. We are reminding ourselves, and he has made it possible for us to do that by virtue of our baptisms. We cannot order God to come and go at our bidding. Although God knows I have heard many a prayer that seems to flow from the assumption that it is precisely what we can think we can do. We come at his bidding. We go at his command and commission. That's where it stands. Now, let's take those words, Holy Spirit, come, and examine them in light of that. Before we ever say those words, where is the Holy Spirit? In a galaxy far, far away? Up in heaven? In some unknown dimension? No. Right here. The Spirit's right here. So why do we need to say, Holy Spirit, come? On one level, we don't. We cannot bring the Holy Spirit by those words, even if we want to. We have no power to do that. But on another level, like with our worship opening invocation, we do remind ourselves that we need a greater awareness of the Spirit's presence. I know some people who I think are pretty much in touch with the Holy Spirit. I've witnessed their devotional life, their prayer life, the way they witness to people, the way they employ spiritual gifts. But even the most ardent practitioner of spiritual disciplines needs a greater awareness of the Spirit's presence. Most of the rest of us desperately need a spiritual dope slap to awaken us to the reality of the presence of the Holy Spirit. Okay, so now I'm going to say, Spirit, come, and I'm going to mean, Spirit, make me the more deeply aware of where you are touching my life. Remember when I called Carol up here, and I kept saying, come here, come here. Even when she already had arrived, come here. We cannot fall into that trap with the Holy Spirit. If you desire a fuller, richer, and deeper awareness of who the Holy Spirit is and what the Holy Spirit is doing in, for, and through your life, then when you say, Holy Spirit, come, you need to shut you so that the Spirit can be known. You need to shut up. Just stand in the Spirit's presence and sense the radiance of the power, the beauty, and the glory that is upon you. Then shut down. Stop being so busy and let this time wash over you and wash you clean. Then shut off. Get rid of the TV, the CD, the DVD, the MP3, and all the other distractions of modern life has put at our disposal. And let the voice of the Spirit speak into your heart. And then shut yourself away. Go to a quiet, safe place where in prayer, meditation, and communion with the Spirit, you can discover the ways that the Spirit wants to use you. I read an older edition of the Christian Century, a monthly journal, where it had pulled from an earlier edition of a spiritual journal called Weavings, this story. A quiet, unassuming woman asked her pastor whether she could accompany him on hospital visits. When he agreed, she asked whether she could pray for the patients they visited. To his great wonderment, over the next several weeks, the people this woman prayed for seemed to get well, both physically and spiritually. He asked her, "Do you think you have the Spirit's gift of healing?" She said, "Yes, I've thought so for about 2 years." Why hadn't she said anything about it before, he wondered.
because you never asked me, and I didn't know what to do with it. It is often hard to pray, Spirit, come, and then to know what has the response of the Spirit been. That's why God places us into a community of faith, where the Spirit is at work in every single person, whether they're aware of that working or not, so that the faith community then can validate what the Spirit seeks to do. Paul teaches us in today's second lesson, there are varieties of gifts, but the same Spirit. There are varieties of services, but the same Lord. And there are varieties of activities, but it is the same God who activates all of them in everyone. Did you catch that? Let me say it again. The same God activates all of them in everyone. You have a gift from the Spirit. Do you know it? Do you use it? If not, then come to me and ask me, are there ways that I can discover what that gift, or more than likely, those gifts, may be? There are things called spiritual gift inventories and other kinds of resources that I can point you to that can help you to discern where the Holy Spirit has already made it plain He is willing to be at work and is already at work in your life. You just didn't know what to ask. So ask. And then pray. In fact, pray with me right now. Holy Spirit, come. Make me aware more and more that you are here with me, beside me, in me, closer than my very breath, deeper than my breathing. Fill me with your presence until I am aglow with you. Come, Holy Spirit. Come. Amen. We rise to join for the hymn for the day.
Holy Spirit, ever working through.
going to make affirmation of our faith. We believe in God, creator of all, whose love is more than mind can measure or time contain. We believe that God's desire is fullness of life for all, and from the heights of heaven to the depths of hell, nothing and no one has fallen beyond the reach of God's mercy. We believe in Jesus Christ, who unveiled the divinity of human flesh and revealed to us the nature of God, who embodied God's holy wisdom and brought forth fruits of love, joy, peace, goodness, faithfulness, and humility. We believe in the way of the cross, for when Christ embraced the outcasts and unmasked the arrogant, he stirred into deadly confrontation the power of love and the love of power. The enemies of life had their way with him, tearing spirit from flesh. But God's saving power raised him to life, so that we and every person on earth might follow him into the fullness of life, which death cannot overcome. We believe in the Holy Spirit, God's ceaseless and mysterious go-between, who kindles the fires of passion and integrity, elusive and uncontrolling, comforting and preserving. He purges our delusions with fire and whispers grace with a lover's breath, empowering us to refuse what is evil and to be taken up with praise. Though sometimes fearful, in God we trust. We lay ourselves open to the Spirit's touch, that we might be the body of Christ, offering our life for the life of the world, and being drawn into the mysterious dance of the Trinity through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory and praise forever. Amen. In our prayers this morning, we pray for the Reverend Dr. Roger Ellis, a friend of mine in Canada, who is still hospitalized for several weeks after complications from back surgery. We pray about the upsurge in the war in Ukraine, as Ukrainian forces began a counterattack into Russia, and Russian forces have increased the drone attacks on the capital, Kyiv. We pray about the continuing gun violence in our own nation, including in the greater Cleveland and Akron areas. We pray concerning the upsurge in auto accidents anticipated over this holiday weekend and for the safety of all those who are traveling. And we pray for the leaders of our nation to arrive at an agreement on how to deal with our debt crisis. In the power of the Spirit who aids us in our weaknesses and teaches us to pray, let us offer to God our intercessions, thanksgivings, and the deep yearnings of our hearts. For the church, that her leaders and servants, and for all the people of God, they may be made whole and free by the Spirit, and bear witness in every aspect of life for the full force of Christ's resurrection. We pray, come, Holy Spirit. For our world in its brokenness, the peace of the risen Christ would heal the wounds of all victims of injustice and exploitation, and transform the hearts of those who lead the nations and who make public policy, that they may truly become makers of peace. We pray, come, Holy Spirit. That liberal and conservative may be drawn together in truth by the Spirit and come to rejoice in their different gifts and points of view. We pray, come, Holy Spirit. For those weighed down by despair, suffering from addiction, or burdened by illness, including Roger and his family, that they may experience the freedom which the Spirit gives to the children of God, we pray, come, Holy Spirit. In thanksgiving for those to whom healing has come, including those we have continued to include on our prayer list, they may ever acknowledge God's goodness and render him due thanks, we pray, come, Holy Spirit. For those who graduate this month and next, our high school and college graduates, for this milestone in their lives and for the hope for the future such milestones bring, we pray, come, Holy Spirit.
in thanksgiving for the departed, and for all who witness to us God's love poured into our hearts by the Spirit, and for the grace to be faithful to all as they have been for us, we pray, come, Holy Spirit. Gracious God, receive our prayer. Hear our hearts' deep yearnings, yet to be formed into words. Give us the courage to yield ourselves, all that we are and have yet to become, to the transforming motion of your Holy Spirit, and carry out in us and through us your work of new creation. We pray this in the name of Jesus Christ, the risen and living one. Amen. Continue with the act of reconciliation. God of power, you have sent the Spirit of love. You have sent the Spirit of joy.
Forgive us all the times we have disagreeable and unwelcoming witnesses.
You have sent the Spirit of peace.
Forgive us all the times our words and actions contribute towards conflict and division.
You have sent the Spirit of patience.
Forgive us all the times we worry because we cannot see the instant results in prayer.
You have sent the Spirit of kindness. You have sent the Spirit of goodness.
Forgive us all the times we have willfully ignored the law of the state, caused pain by our words or actions.
You have sent the Spirit of faithfulness.
Forgive us all the times our discipleship has lacked credibility.
You have sent the Spirit of gentleness.
Forgive us all the times we have been aggressive in our attitude towards others.
You have sent the Spirit of self-control. Gracious and merciful God, give us your forgiveness and your love that we may truly care for one another.
Refresh and renew us with your Spirit so that we can be fruitful and vital disciples of Jesus Christ. Amen.
We are forgiven and reconciled to God through Christ our Lord. Therefore, let us be reconciled with one another and share the peace of the Lord. Thank you.
Let us pray. Blessed are you, O Lord, our God, maker of all things. Through your goodness, you have blessed us with these gifts. With them, we offer ourselves to your service and dedicate our lives to the care and redemption of all that you have made, for the sake of him who gave himself for us, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is our duty and delight at all times and in all places to give thanks to you, O Lord, Holy Father, through Christ our Lord, who by his cross and resurrection has made us a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people set apart, that through us he might unite in love people of every time and race and nation. And so with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and light, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy God, mighty Lord, gracious Father, endless is your mercy and eternal your reign. You have filled all creation with light and life. Everything, everywhere is full of your glory. You made humans in your image, the crown of creation. Through Abraham, you promised to bless all humanity. You rescued Israel, your chosen, the people of your promise. You sent them prophets with words of judgment and of hope. And when the time had come, you sent your Son, born of Mary by the power of the Holy Spirit. In words and wonders, he proclaimed your kingdom and was obedient to your will, even to giving his life. At supper the night he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took some bread in his hands, and then when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his friends, and he said, "Take this and eat it. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." After supper he took a cup of wine, and after giving thanks he gave it to them, and he said, "Drink from this, all of you. This cup is God's new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you and for all for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink from it from now on, do this to remember me." Gracious Father, we therefore celebrate the sacrifice of our Lord by means of this holy bread and cup, rejoicing to receive all that he accomplished for us in his life and death, his resurrection and ascension, and awaiting his coming again to share with us the heavenly feast.
Amen. Come, Lord Jesus.
Send the power of your Holy Spirit upon us and upon this bread and wine, that we who receive the body and blood of Christ may be his body in the world, living according to his example, to bring peace and healing to all humanity. Join our prayers of those of your servants of every time and every place, and unite them with the ceaseless petitions of our great high priest, until he comes in power and great glory as victorious Lord of all. Through him, with him, in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Body of our Lord Jesus Christ and his precious blood, strengthen and preserve you in true faith to life everlasting. Depart in peace. Amen. The body of our Lord Jesus Christ and his precious blood strengthen and preserve you in true faith to life everlasting. Depart in peace. Amen. We rise for the post-communion prayer. Let us pray. Brought upon us the spirit of your love, O Lord, and unite the wills of those whom you have fed with one heavenly food, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Go out into the world sent as Christ Jesus was sent, gifted and empowered for the common good. Dream dreams, pursue visions, and speak of God's goodness in the words of those who would hear. Give hope to your dreaming. Christ Jesus sent rivers of life flowing within you. The Holy Spirit unites you as one body and sets you ablaze with joy. Amen. Self-giving love of Jesus Christ that he modeled for us, which has been imitated in the self-giving love of those men and women who died in military service to our country. We pray and remember for our soldiers who laid down their lives for their friends and fellow citizens. We remember and we pray for those who did not lay down their lives, but who suffered physical, emotional, or mental damage and need healing.
We remember and we pray for those families who are grieving.
We remember and we pray for those soldiers and military family members who need our ongoing support and care.
We remember and we pray for our leaders, to honor our soldiers, and all of us by leading
We remember and we pray for the example of Jesus Christ to be the vision of service for all of us, whoever we are and wherever we are. On this Sunday before Memorial Day, we pray all of this in the name of the Prince of Peace, Jesus the Christ.
Amen.
Please be seated. Go in peace. Serve the Lord.